Stop being so. Pray that God has the man here for you that you need. And in the meantime, again, it's just so enjoyable being with you and being able to serve you good folks here. And that is the topic today. The message title is So We Can Serve. And it comes from our Psalm reading, Psalm 130. And we're going to talk about what makes it possible and why we serve. And we'll have a couple of military stories to tell and illustrations, and then dive into God's word together. But let's start with prayer. Father, we thank you, Lord, for the blessings of this day. Lord, prepare our hearts, prepare our lives. Help us to trust the process that you put us through so that we can better serve you and serve one another. That's our purpose here, Lord. We need to especially share the hope of the gospel that we have, the hope of Jesus within us, with a hurting world, Lord, that doesn't know, too often does not know what love is, true love, does not know what self-sacrificing concern for others is, that doesn't understand who you are, that rejects you for the wrong reasons, that finds excuses to avoid you. Lord, help us to be a witness. But Lord, help us to start with ourselves and coming into fellowship with you, coming close to you. So we pray this morning, Lord, that you would, in this service, draw us close to you. And we pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's stand for our opening praise songs. Thank you. True heart and confess our sins to God the Father, imploring Him in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ to grant us forgiveness. Our help is in the name of the Lord.
Made heaven and earth.
I said I will confess my transgressions to the Lord.
And you forgave me my sin.
O Almighty God, merciful Father,
I am a poor miserable sinner. Bless you, all my sins and iniquities, with which I have ever offended you, and justly deserve your punishment, now and forever. But I am heartily sorry for them, and sincerely repent of them, and I pray for your promise and mercy, for the sake of all the innocent and the sovereign of heaven, of your beloved Son, Jesus Christ, to be gracious and merciful to me.
Upon this, your confession, I, as a called and ordained servant of the word, announce the grace of God to all of you. And in the stead, and by the command of my Lord Jesus Christ, I forgive you all your sins, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Together we affirm our faith with the words of the Apostles' Creed.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven, and sits at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
Amen. And we read responsibly Psalm 130. Out of the depths I cry to you, Lord.
Lord, hear my voice. Let your ears be attentive to my cry for mercy.
If you, Lord, kept a record of sins, Lord, who could stand?
But we do there as forgiveness, so that I can, with reverence, serve
you. I wait for the Lord. My whole being waits, and in his word I put my hope.
I wait for the Lord, and watch and wait for the morning.
Israel, put your hope in the Lord, for with the hope, with the Lord is unfailing love, and with him is full redemption.
He himself will redeem Israel from all their sins.
Please be seated. Our Old Testament reading is from Genesis chapter 3, verses 8 through 15. Then the man and his wife heard the sound of the Lord God as he was walking in the garden in the cool of the day. And they hid from the Lord God among the trees of the garden. But the Lord God called to the man, "Where are you?" He answered, "I heard you in the garden, and I was afraid because I was naked, so I hid." And he said, "Who told you that you were naked? Have you eaten from the tree that I commanded you not to eat from?" The man said, "The woman you put here with me, she gave me some fruit from the tree, and I ate it." Then the Lord God said to the woman, "What is this you have done?" The woman said, "The serpent deceived me, and I ate." So the Lord God said to the serpent, "Because you have done this, cursed are you above all livestock and all wild animals. You will crawl on your belly and will eat dust all the days of your life. And I will put enmity between you and the woman and between your offspring and hers. He will crush your head and you will strike his heel." Our New Testament reading is from Paul's letter to the Corinthians, 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verses 13 through chapter 5, verse 1. It is written, "I believed, therefore I have spoken. Since we have that same spirit of faith, we also believe and therefore speak, because we know that the one who raised the Lord Jesus from the dead will also raise us with Jesus and present us with you to himself. All this is for your benefit, so that the grace that is reaching more and more people may cause thanksgiving to overflow to the glory of God. Therefore, we do not lose heart. Though outwardly we are wasting away, yet inwardly we are being renewed day by day. For our light and momentary troubles are achieving for us an eternal glory that far outweighs them all. So we fix our eyes not on what is seen, but on what is unseen. Since what is seen is temporary, but what is unseen is eternal. For we know that if the earthly tent we live in is destroyed, we have a building from God, an eternal house in heaven, not built by human hands." Our gospel reading is from Mark chapter 3, verses 20 to 35. Then Jesus entered a house, and again a crowd gathered, so that he and his disciples were not even able to eat. When his family heard about this, they went to take charge of him, for they said, "He is out of his mind." And the teachers of the law who came down from Jerusalem said, "He is possessed by Beelzebul. By the prince of demons, he's driving out demons." So Jesus called them over to him and began to speak to them in parables. "How can Satan drive out Satan? If a kingdom is divided against itself, that kingdom cannot stand. If a house is divided against itself, that house cannot stand. And if Satan opposes himself and is divided, he cannot stand. His end has come. In fact, no one can enter a strong man's house without first tying him up. Then he can plunder the strong man's house. Truly, I tell you, people can be forgiven all their sins and every slander they utter. But whoever blasphemes against the Holy Spirit will never be forgiven. They are guilty of an eternal sin." He said this because they were saying, "He has an impure spirit." Then Jesus' mother and brothers arrived. Standing outside, they sent someone in to call him. A crowd was sitting around him, and they told him, "Your mother and brothers are outside looking for you." "Who are my mother and my brothers?" he asked. Then he looked at those seated in a circle around him and said, "Here are my mother and my brothers. Whoever does God's will is my brother and sister and mother." These are our scripture readings. We join together in our message song, "Take My Life, O Lord, Renew."
Thank you.
Please follow along as we usually do the outline in your worship folder on the screen as we consider the scripture readings once again that are appointed for this Sunday in Pentecost. And the season is green. That's a color for the season of Pentecost. Green for growth. And it is. It's a time to, especially, we do this every Sunday. We think about how we can grow. In fact, we have this on the worship folder about growing together, growing closer to the Lord, growing closer to one another, growing in our learning and our understanding, but also our mission and our ministry. We pray that this is always the case. Green for growth. Today, we're thinking about this theme, which Psalm 130 suggests, where it says, if you, Lord, kept a record of sins, Lord, who could stand? But with you there is forgiveness, so that we can, with reverence, serve you. And we say this, God saves so that we can serve. And when I was preparing the message earlier this week, looking at this psalm, I was contemplating about making the title, Who Could Stand? Thinking about, wow, if you, Lord, kept a record of sins. We know our lives. We know our history, don't we? We know our youth, our foolish and sometimes sinful youth. We know who we are, warts and all. And sometimes the warts seem to be many, right? We have weaknesses. Even if we're not messing things up, we lack faith too often. Many times, I hear people say, or I've said it myself or heard other people say, I wish my faith were stronger, right? I wish I could have a stronger faith. So even if we're not proactively sinning, we're failing in terms of what we call sins of omission, including, most fundamentally, a failure to believe, a failure to trust God. And it's not having a strong faith, it's having faith in the object of our faith. God himself. You know, we think often, I think often about the example of Peter, because I relate to Peter. Open mouth, insert foot. He had weaknesses. And one of his problems was lack of faith. Jesus reproves him for it. But I always have this little footnote in my head about Peter walking on water and then starting to sink. He still knew who to turn to. Save me, Lord, he says. He still knew that, and that is the fundamental lesson of faith. It's not faith in your ability to walk on water. Otherwise, I think actually he did pretty well, right? I mean, I've never seen anybody walk on water at all. I mean, at least he made it a little ways, right? But he knew who to cry out to, and actually there's a an object lesson, a lesson here in who do you turn to when you are sinking? It's faith. It's growth. I was thinking about who could stand as the theme here, but then I thought, you know, that's kind of the process we go through. But it's not the end goal. It is very important. It is fundamental. It is foundational to understand that in our sinful lives, in our history, that's our checkered past, there is forgiveness. You got to have that down. You got to understand that. Otherwise, you're going to think that you can earn your way to heaven and forget about it. You cannot. You can't do it. Nobody can, because God's standard is perfection, and we fall far short of perfection. Sinning is literally missing the mark. We've missed the mark. So forget about earning your way to heaven. But there is forgiveness with the Lord. So we can stand, not in our own stuff that we do, in our own strength, in our own faith, in our own goodness, but we stand with the Lord in the strength he gives, and it comes with Jesus. It's why Jesus came. That's how we can stand. But here, I kind of shifted gears when I was preparing this message and thinking beyond the sin and who could stand and all of this to the ultimate goal. And what is that? Okay, so we're forgiven in this life. We know that. Well, once we're forgiven, once we've become a Christian, maybe even when we're baptized, Lord, just take us to heaven, because now we've arrived, right? Why does he leave us here if we're already saved? Here's why. So we can serve. So we can serve. There are other people who need to hear the good news that you and I have received ourselves. There are things that need to be done that are good things that won't be done if we don't do them. God has called each of us in our place, in our purpose, to serve him and to serve others, to do the right thing, to stand on truth, to promote the gospel, to show mercy where mercy needs to be shown, to speak truth where light needs to be shown in the darkness. There are ways that each one of us have to serve that only we individually are able to serve. There are people you know, and you know well, who I may never meet, who may never hear the gospel unless you share it with them, who never will understand how they too can have hope in the midst of a life that sometimes can seem hopeless. And you can say, you know what, I've had the same struggle as you, but here's what I've discovered, that God and his word are true, that his promises are faithful. And my faith has made a difference in my life, and it can make a difference in your life too. That's serving. Each of us has a place to serve. But then there are things that get in the way of our service. And again, thinking about earlier in the week when I was preparing this, and thinking about the object, it's that, as the psalmist says, so that, that's a purpose clause, so that we can, with reverence, with humility, serve you. God saves so we can serve. Let's look at this then. Number one, when we sin, and here again, we're looking at what can stand in the way. When we sin, we do not hide or make excuses. Let's add another one there you can put in the margin. We don't blame. We don't blame others. I find humor in Genesis chapter 3. Along with the tragedy of Adam and Eve sinning and drawing the whole human race down into what sometimes is hell on earth because of their sin. And we all follow in that sin by what we do or fail to do. In the midst of all of this, I see a bit of humor. It gets to the point about hiding, making excuses, or even blaming somebody else for our sin, for our problem, for what we should take responsibility for. What happens here in the sequence? Well, we back up just to give the context. Adam and Eve were created by God, placed in the garden. It was a perfect place. They were told they could have anything they want in the garden, except they should not eat from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. And of course, being people, they chose poorly. And they ate from that tree. And then they understood their situation. Hey, we're naked. And it was more than just the physical nakedness. It was being naked, understanding all of the things that then draw us further into sin. And here, we're not saying that sex is a bad thing or distinction between man and woman is a bad thing, but it is the perversion of all of that. And they now knew about this. And by the way, and here's some of the humor where it starts. Adam tries to hide from God. How well does that work, to hide from God? Have you ever tried to hide from God? How well has that worked for you? I think Dr. Phil's the one who says, and how's that working for you, right? Can we hide from God? No, we can't hide from God. We know he's always there. He is what we call omniscient, all-knowing. He knows and sees everything. So we know we can't hide, but still we try and escape. Hey, I was afraid because I was naked. Now, God asked Adam a question here. Who told you that you were naked? Have you eaten from the tree that I commanded you not to eat from? This is what we might call a rhetorical question. Do you think God knew the answer to the questions he asked here? Absolutely. The questions are not for God's information, but to confront Adam with his sin. That's the purpose here. And so Adam responds saying, yes, it's all my fault. I take full responsibility, right? Mm-hmm. It gets funnier here, doesn't it? There is humor here. This woman, the woman you put with me here, she gave me some fruit from the tree. And I ate it. Hey, talk to her. It's not my fault. It's her fault. This woman you gave me, and actually he's blaming God too, not just the woman, right? Hey, you gave her to me. It wasn't my idea. You shackled me to this person, right? You said it was good not to be alone. Maybe it would have been better to be alone. But this woman dragged me down. It's all her fault. Now, I have never blamed my wife for anything. I would never do this. Right, Elaine? Don't laugh too much. How often have you blamed your spouse? There's room for women, too, here for this, okay, this question. All right. So he blames the woman. And by extension, blames God. But God is going to play along with this. So he goes to the woman. He goes to Eve. What is this you have done? Does he know the answer? Yes, he does, once again. But it's time to confront the woman. Because, in fact, she is responsible as well. And the woman says, yes, Lord, it's my fault. I take full responsibility. Is that what she says? No. Hey, the serpent deceived me. It's not my fault. He did it. He made me do it. And I ate. Now, indeed, the serpent did get that ball rolling. So God goes to the root and the cause of all of this. But man and woman have had to suffer consequences of the fall ever since. But God goes to the source of the trouble, to Satan the serpent himself. And he says this, because you've done this, cursed are you above all livestock and all wild animals. You'll crawl on your belly and you'll eat dust all the days of your life. Now here, I want to inject this little thought here, not exactly on point, but I want you to consider this. We should have some room for some humility about these accounts in the scripture. We shouldn't be too quick to judge or to criticize or to look down our nose at what some people have called mythology. We need to save room for humility in the face of God and his word. You and I weren't there. it would probably be good for us to receive this at face value here. Because indeed, we see the results today and in all of history that mankind has fallen into sin, that there is a huge problem in the human condition. So maybe we ought to listen to how this all got started and account for it. Now here there's room for acknowledging that this is not just an ordinary snake, okay? But there's an imagery here that is used. And Satan has been called throughout scripture all the way to from Genesis to Revelation, the serpent. But there's imagery here of crawling in the dust. The lowest of the low. Just this past week, I was watching an old video of Steve Irwin, the animal guy from Australia. And later in his life, he actually died. He got killed by a wild animal in the ocean. But he could handle snakes remarkably well. I was showing my grandchildren a snake skin, a rattlesnake skin from rattlesnake that I picked up when I was younger. And did it very carefully, but it can be done. You just have to hold on to the head pretty good, or do what Steve Irwin does, grab by the tail and hold it up in a way. These things can kill you if you're not careful. But I thought when I was younger, I wanted to be maybe a herpetologist, somebody who'd study snakes. And so, by the way, who made the snakes? Did Satan make snakes? No, God did. They're part of creation. Okay. But there is a useful image here, and we need a little humility in looking at these accounts. Okay, let's move on to the point. Adam and Eve did not accept responsibility, but they had to accept consequences. You can debate, you can argue with the narrative. You can claim your own narrative. This is my truth that I'm going to say is true for me, and you can't tell me differently. I don't care who you are, especially God can't tell me. But it's hard to argue with consequences. The Dr. Phil question, how's that working for you? There are consequences. But God proclaims judgment on the serpent. Now here, verse 15, I want you to really take special note of this. And again, when we sin, we do not hide or make excuses. That's the fill in the blank thing here. Do not hide or make excuses or blame. Genesis 3:15 is what theologians call the proto-evangelion. This is the first promise in Scripture about the coming Messiah, about Jesus. And it's in Genesis chapter 3. It occurs, God makes his promise of Jesus immediately after his word of judgment. He does not wait until Exodus, Numbers, Deuteronomy, Leviticus, Joshua, Judges, Ruth, all the rest of the books of the Bible. He does not wait. Immediately, he makes a promise of how he is going to fix our problem. How he is going to deal with our sin and with our denial, with our hiding, with our excuse making, with our blame game that we play. Even then, he does not make judgment final. He does not tell Adam and Eve, you messed up. You didn't do what I said. I'm going to destroy you. I'm going to destroy the world. I'm going to start with a whole new, not just planet, a whole new universe. Could God have done that? If he made the first one, he could probably make another one, right? But he didn't. Why? Because as John says in his first epistle, God is what? Love. God is love. He loves the creation he made. He loves the people he made. He loves us past our sin, our failure, our hypocrisy, our blame game, our hiding, our excuse making. He sees beyond our sin to our need. He loves us. That's why. So he gives the promise. And this is the first promise about Jesus coming in the Bible immediately after the fall. And I will put enmity, he's speaking to the serpent, the judgment here of Satan, I will put enmity between you and the woman, and between your offspring and hers. He will crush your head, and you will strike his heel." Now, I challenge you on something here. I've taken this challenge myself, and I've never been able to contradict my conclusion based on this one verse. Is there any other event in all of history, other than Calvary and the cross on Calvary and Jesus' crucifixion, is there any other event in all of human history that this can describe other than Jesus' crucifixion? And I say, with absolute conviction, you make your own study, you do your own conclusion, but in fairness, I think you'll arrive at the same conclusion. There's nothing else, no other event in all of human history that fits this prophecy, this judgment here from God, other than Christ's crucifixion. I will put enmity between you and the woman, between your offspring and hers. In the old King James, your seed and hers. And the seed here being the messianic line, the line of descendants that is recorded in Scripture from Adam and Eve all the way to Jesus. You can find it in the Old Testament, but also referenced in the New Testament Gospels. The line, the seed of Adam and Eve leading to Jesus. And then the genealogy gets destroyed at that point with the destruction of the temple, AD 70. God put his stamp of finished on it. But we see the prophecy fulfilled, that the seed of the woman leads to Jesus. And the people of Israel are the seed from which this ultimate seed from God comes from, Jesus the Messiah. There's nobody else this fits other than the Jewish people and the seed from the Jewish people, the messianic line leading to Jesus the Messiah, the promised one, the anointed one, come to save us from our sin. Come to save us from that certain serpent's temptation. Now, here's the next part of this sentence here, verse 15, chapter 3 of Genesis. He will crush your head and you will strike your heel. A couple of questions here. Is a strike to the heel fatal from a poisonous serpent? Maybe. But you could amputate the foot, or you could recover, maybe, right? But if you're going to get a crushed head, if your head is going to get crushed, is there any antivenin in the world that's going to save you? Is there any surgery in the world that's going to save you, even today in the 21st century? If your head gets crushed, you're going to die. And so what God is doing is he's pronouncing judgment on the devil. He's saying that the seed is going to crush Satan's head. But in the process, the seed is going to have his heel struck. The crucifixion is the only event in all of human history that matches that description. When Jesus is hanging on the cross, did he die? Yes, he did. Did he stay dead? No, he didn't. Ultimately, it was not a fatal strike. It looked to be that way, but it wasn't. But with his death on the cross, did he kill Satan and all of the sin that Satan brought? Yes. Now we have to say, are there still consequences in this world? Of course there are. There's still sin and tragedy and evil in the world. But the mechanism for forgiveness, for hope, for eternal life is there. For just some people? No, for the whole world. God so loved the world that he gave his only son that whoever believes in him will not perish. God gives us the answer. We have no reason anymore to hide, to make excuses or blame. We can take full responsibility. It's called confession. But the word in response from God is not judgment, but forgiveness. because of the blood of Jesus that washes away all of our sin. That's why Jesus came. Number two, when we suffer, we do not lose heart. We do not lose heart. And there is suffering in the world, isn't there? We've all experienced this one way or another. Paul here says some very interesting things. Paul had an understanding of suffering personally. We see, and he has an account. He was shipwrecked. He was beaten. He was stoned. He was persecuted in so many ways. He was locked up. And did he ever give up? No, he did not. And it's because he had this remarkable capability. We ask, why didn't he cave in? He had this remarkable capability to look beyond what is seen to what is unseen. He says here in Corinthians, 2 Corinthians, verse 16, therefore, we do not lose heart. Though outwardly we are wasting away, yet inwardly we are being renewed day by day. And he goes on, he gives the secret about this. He says, verse 18, so we fix our eyes not on what is seen, but on what is unseen. Since what is seen is temporary, but what is unseen is eternal. There's the key, folks, right there. You can face anything in life if you lift your eyes beyond your circumstances, beyond what you can see to what you cannot see, but what you receive by faith, because that's real. And it gives real strength for today, for the issues, for the problems, for the circumstances, for the suffering that you face. You can fix your eyes on Jesus. We see this in Hebrews, in the New Testament here, where it may be Paul, it may be another author, but it's the same thought. Paul says, verse 18, so we fix our eyes not on what is seen, but as what is unseen. Hebrews chapter 12 says this, therefore, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, let us throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles, and let us run with perseverance the race marked out for us. And here's the verse 2 point here. Let us fix our eyes on Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith, who for the joy set before him endured the cross. We look beyond the temporary. We have a couple of examples. And really, this is wrapping both point 1 and 2 together here from the military. And remember, this past week we celebrated Memorial Day. I was talking to my grandson this past week, who's visiting with us. And I was talking to him about not making excuses. And he's interested in maybe joining the military someday, maybe the Marines, we'll see. And we were having a conversation about not making excuses. And I said, how well is it going to work in the Marines if you explain to the gunny sergeant that, hey, it's not your fault because of this or that? How well is that going to go over? And then I think about the Navy SEALs, and these are remarkable people, remarkable men who do the impossible, it seems. And their training regimen to prepare them is almost unbelievable, what they have to go through. And how tough they are. And they never make excuses. They learn early on, it's always your responsibility. Don't blame or excuse or deny. But then I'm thinking about this losing heart, this suffering thing. This is the point two here, another military example. And there was a man by the name of Dick Winters. And he was a key leader in what's called the Band of Brothers. You know that series that's been on? And again, we think about this past Memorial Day. And he was a lieutenant at the time, and he was a paratrooper. He was in E Company, 506th Regiment of the 101st Airborne Division, jumping into Normandy on D-Day early in the morning and having tremendous problems. On the way down, the plane was flying too low, too fast because of the enemy ground fire. He had to jump out at those less than ideal conditions. He lost the bag that was attached to him. He lost his weapon. He had to pick up a dead soldier's weapon to fight with. He had to collect guys who were scattered all over, and he had to lead. And his assignment was to take out 4 enemy guns, 105 millimeter howitzers, that were shelling the beach at Utah Beach. And he got a group of guys and he did the mission, as hard as it was. He did not lose heart. He went ahead and he did the job, not knowing what the consequences were if he didn't or did do the job. He just did it. And he, I watched a video from him, and he was talking about all of his experiences and talking about how important prayer is, not just for survival, to pray to survive, not just about yourself, but about the mission that you have. And when you suffer doing that mission, you keep your eyes on the mission and you don't lose heart. And he didn't, and he was very courageous. Years later, there's this book published by Dr. Stephen Ambrose called Band of Brothers, which was later made into the series. 1992, this book came out. And the, a former Defense Department leader, Elliot Richardson, former Secretary of Defense, he had been on Utah Beach on June 6th in the Normandy invasion. And they were taking tremendous fire from guns, these big, heavy guns. And he rescued this one man who was wounded, and they had to make their way through the gunfire. And all of a sudden, the gunfire stopped. And he didn't discover until 1992, when he read the book, that it was Dick Winters and what Dick did to silence those guns above Utah Beach that has saved his life and the life of others down there on the beach. It took that long for Dick Winters to learn what he had accomplished that day. But he didn't lose heart. He didn't see the ultimate result, but he was faithful. We need to be faithful as well. Let's close with a final thought here. When we receive God's Spirit, we do God's will. We do God's will. That's the purpose of it all, and it's a good purpose. And here I'm going to get all the way to the end here. Verse 35, Mark chapter 3. Whoever does God's will is my brother and sister and mother. There's a purpose for everything that we have, everything that we are, why we're here, what God has intended for us, each one of us. You don't have to be president of the United States. You don't have to be a pastor. You don't have to be a missionary. You don't have to be Dick Winters. You don't have to be these other figures. You figure out why God's got you here. He will show you. He will work with you. Do God's will. Trust him. Go beyond your problems to see how you too can serve. Don't rely on yourself and your own strength, your own ability to be good. Rely on Jesus' forgiveness. Don't make excuses. Look to the Lord when you suffer. Consider what he's called you to do. Do his will. Let's pray.
Father in heaven, Lord, help us to see beyond our temporary problems that we have. Help us to trust your promises. Help us to understand that, yes, we are forgiven. We don't have to look back with guilt at our past life or sin. Jesus took all those things to the cross. Lord, he fulfilled that promise from Genesis 3. Lord, our sins are washed away because of him. Lord, help us to be strong in the suffering that we endure. Help us look beyond. Help us to fix our eyes on Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith. Lord, help us to believe in your promises so that we have strength to do your will. Lord, this day we pray for a special blessing for the meeting today. Pray, Lord, that you would continue to lead this congregation here in Living Word as you have in the past. We pray, Lord, that you'd provide the man that needs to serve here. Lord, in the meantime, we trust you and we keep working step by step, day by day, being faithful. living in your love, living in your purpose, serving you. Help us to be faithful in that. Lord, we pray for our poor, hurting world and all the problems, the warfare, the terrorism we see here and around the world. We pray, Lord, for reconciliation and discord that we have in this country. We pray, Lord, that you would bring about justice and truth, and that people would be united instead of divided. Lord, we pray that you would bless our leaders and raise up good leaders. Lord, we pray for healing for those who need healing. We pray for Dottie, Craig, Julie, Bob, Jim, Mary, Pastor John, Neil, Peter, Melissa, Karen, Jay, Dan, Margaret, Brianna, and Bob. Lord, be with them. Put your healing hand on them. We pray for safe journeys for Bob and or Mark and daughter Julie. Pray, Lord, for good results in medical treatments. Lord, we commend in your hands all of our concerns, both spoken and unspoken in our hearts. The things that worry us, the things that preoccupy us, the things that try to take our eyes off of you. We pray that we would put our eyes firmly on you and our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And now, Lord, we sum up all of our prayers in the prayer he has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you his peace.
Amen.
Please stand for our closing song.
Just a quick few announcements, and then I'll let you guys go get a snack and some coffee, but I'd like to start the meeting, you know, within the next 15 minutes or so, just so we can get on with our day. So just a few reminders. I will have a VBS sign-up sheet for items that we need. It's going to look like it'll most likely just be like whatever food we need. I've already bought all the crafts, and most of the games are pretty easy this year. So it'll look like we just need a lot of food items. So that will be that. Our mission of the month this month is Lutheran Church Charities. So we're collecting donations. As you know, that that charity had a big heart for Pastor John, so I thought it was a good thing for this month as well. We will talk more in the meeting about the survey as well that is coming out. So just please be aware that there will be an email. It's going to come from a different, it'll come from Living Word, but it's going to be a different email so that we can just see who's opening it and if we need to let people know a different way to get it. But we will have that survey coming out. We'll talk a little bit more about that in the meeting. And I think that's all that I have. Yes, Christy.
Thank you, Kathy.
Oh, yes. Thank you, Kathy. Kathy cleaned out the kitchen and did an amazing job. Thank you. It looks amazing. Thank you so much. Any other announcements before we go? All right, well then I'd say go ahead and wave to the camera, grab a coffee and a snack, and be back in here in a few minutes, please.
Right now.